1 Corinthians 14. Have you ever thought, and I probably haven't, but I was thinking about it today, what would happen if all of a sudden gravity was switched off? I mean, it's something to think about. Google that, dudes. Yeah, blow your mind what they've come up with that would happen. I mean, gravity is universal. Gravity is, I mean, it's everywhere. And the fact that it just happened, it's just mind-blowing. Yeah, the Big Bang, and then we had gravity, and it all came to, but think about it. I mean, you know, the Earth is spinning, right? So no gravitational force on us. Where would we go right now? Poof. Everything would, the water in the oceans, buildings that aren't attached real well, cars. I mean, think about it. It would be what was called chaos, completely out of control. It would be wild. And there are even, you know, the studies they've done on astronauts in space, what takes place and what happens to the body. Even if you didn't die from just the initial effects, your body would eventually die. Red blood cells don't produce, right? The body, the muscles atrophy, just all kinds of things happen. Didn't they even think about the idea that the atom would just, and if that would happen, it'd be like us all being tossed into a microwave. That wouldn't be good. Kind of ugly, huh? Anyhow, the point I'm trying to make is, in the Corinthian church, Paul here, remember, setting things in order, in this passage, this area of these chapters, he's setting in order the behavior of the church. And the Corinthian church, in a sense, was out of control. It was in chaos. If you read chapter 14, verse 26, it says, whenever you come together, each of you has a psalm, has a teaching, has a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation. And what he's saying is that they were all coming together, and it was, because of the pride, it was a free-for-all. There was no order, no control. It was anybody, anytime, any place, and with the idea that I'm not going to be, you know, bettered by you. Oh, you know, Paul gets a tongue, I can do better than that. And then a person says, well, I'm going to do better than you. And then somebody stands up and gives a prophecy, and the other person's like, you call that prophecy? I'll give you prophecy. And just chaos. Paul's setting things in order. But remember last week, verse 13 of chapter 13, and now abide faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest is love. In verse 1 of 14, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. So the umbrella over the whole thing is, of course, love. The Corinthian church didn't have love for one another. So in their gatherings together, there was total disrespect, disregard for each other. It was all about what I was going to get out of the service and what I have for me to edify me. Paul says, no, love, you guys. Love, based upon what he said there in chapter 13. He continues this instruction on how things are to be done in the church, specifically talking about the gifts, prophecy and tongues, and then in this chapter he also talks about how the women were to act within the church. And we'll get to that, and we'll look at the context of that. But verse 1, of course, sets the tone, the emphasis, pursue love, desire the spiritual, the gifts, but especially prophecy. Remember we talked last week about the things that they were to desire the gifts that bring, not last week before, that bring the serviceable gifts that edify you and build you up, not myself. And of course, this thing of prophecy is exactly what this does. Paul, of course, examines both these gifts, lining them up kind of side by side, and which one will do the most good, and the one that will edify the church most. Verse 19 says it's all. Turn to verse 19. Yet in the church, I would rather speak five words with my understanding that I may teach others also than 10,000 words in a tongue. So here's five words, all right? Jesus saves men from sins. The book of Proverbs is almost 10,000 words. 5 to 10,000 in a tongue. So what is Paul really, right up front in this chapter, what does he do with the book of, with the gift of tongues? See, the Corinthians had elevated it. It was, you know, prophecy, that's cool. Tongues, right there. Oh, my gosh. No, no. Prophecy is elevated. The gift of tongues, in a sense, is demoted, brought way down. And in the church, of course, even today, as back then, the whole gift of tongues was widely abused, is widely abused, even to the point that in some churches, that if you don't have the gift of tongues, guess what? You're not going to heaven because you're not saved. That was there. That's the evidence of your salvation, is you have the gift of tongues, you speak in tongues. It does not line up with Scripture at all. I don't understand that. But Paul, though, he never forbids tongues. He just puts it in its proper place. Like I said, Corinthians had elevated it. Paul puts it where it's supposed to be. Why? Because it didn't do for the church what prophesying could do. So, verse 1 through 25 tonight, two big main points. And this one first, the gifts, prophecy in tongues, verses 1 through 25. We're going to cruise through this as fast as I can. A lot of chapters to cover. And then we're going to come back to really basically chapter or verse 3 and hone in on what prophecy does and how it edifies and builds up the church. But he talks about, first off, the gifts, prophecy in tongues. And the prophecy, of course, is God speaking through man. It means to speak forth, to foretell. And it could be the foretelling of the future events as in the prophets, in the books of prophecy. Men inspired by God to speak of events that were yet to come. Probably the wildest is Book of Revelation. But it's also speaking a word into somebody's life. Somebody can stand up and give a prophecy that would speak a word of God into your life. But the most common, and what we are used to most of, is what is taking place now, what takes place at the pulpit, speaking God's word and speaking it forth is prophecy, foretelling God's word. And now speaking in tongues, of course, is man speaking to God. Prophecy, God speaking to men, through men. Speaking in tongues is designed really in this idea where I come to the place where I just can't express myself in words that I have. You've all had that. I just don't have the words to say. Well, that's when the gift of tongues, the Spirit would inspire you to speak in such a way that it was a spiritual language that helped you express praises and adoration and glory to God. And the two words for tongues, glossolalia, that's an unknown spiritual language, sometimes described by people as gibberish in a way of slamming it, or a prayer language. Or dialectos, a known language, but not known by the speaker, as in the book of Acts. You read through that, and the word for tongues is used there both ways. Now, in the book of Acts, they spoke in tongues, in languages, and that the other people didn't know them, but they could hear it in their own language. Pretty crazy. And again, authentic tongues is when a person just doesn't have the words, and it's always a praise. It's not a thus says the Lord. Tongues is praise to God, as in the book of Acts there it says they were declaring the wonderful praises, the works of God, awesome works, the words that bring honor and glory to Him. So that's what the tongues is. But here in verse 1 through 5, we have what Paul says really is prophecy is greater. And we have a proper pursuit here, though. Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Love the more excellent way. Prophecy you should all desire, because in tongues we are speaking to God, but prophecy is man, God speaking through men to you, where I am built up, and you can understand. And prophecy's advantage in verse 3 through 5, but he who prophesies, here it is, speaks edification, exhortation, and comfort to men. And he who speaks in a tongue, though, edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. And I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied, for he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with a tongue, unless indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification. And of course, the problem with tongues, and Paul lays it out here, if you have a tongue, how do you know for sure someone has an interpretation? So there's the challenge that is there. So you speak out in tongue, but there is no interpretation. And years ago when we did these things called afterglows, you know, there were times when, you know, we would get the lights all down and we're just waiting on the Lord. And it was awesome. It really was. Back in the wait in the beginning of Calvary and all that, a lot of that took place. Yeah, the old man here has been there for a long time. Well, I was looking at Ben. Anyhow, I was actually back then too. See, the days that just, but we were doing a different type of afterglow. We was glowing, all right. But this idea, though, that people would stand up and there would be a tongue, and then they would wait for an interpretation. But no one would interpret, so then that was not a valid tongue. So disregard that tongue. Sit down, shut up, basically what they were saying, and don't be doing anything. But of course, in this prophecy's advantage, it edifies, it exhorts, it comforts. We're going to come back to the description of those words. But tongues, of course, was edifying self and the problem with the church there, the pride that was there. But prophecy edifies the church. So we have prophecy being greater. Number 2, verse 6 through 11, we see why tongues fall short, though. It says, but now, brethren, if I come to you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you unless I speak to you either by revelation, by knowledge, by prophesying, or by teaching? So he's saying the tongues don't do any of that. You don't get any instruction, any edification really out of a tongue, especially if it's not interpreted. Even things without life, whether flute or harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the sounds, how will it be known what is piped or played? Basically, he's saying tongues, you know, obviously they're not easy to understand. Somebody speaks in a tongue right now, most of us, if not all of us, are going to go, what did you just say? Unless you have the gift and God gives you that supernatural gift and you speak forth what the person said. Now, the interpretation, man, that's cool. The tongue was, that's kind of strange because you can't understand it. And it does, people use the word gibberish because it could be kind of goofy in its sound. Verse 8, though, for if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare the bat for battle? So it's a waste almost. You blow the trumpet, you know the sound, you're ready for battle, but if the sound's not familiar, it doesn't do anybody any good. It doesn't help. And he says, so likewise, you, unless you utter by the tongue words easy to understand, how will it be known what is spoken? For you'll be speaking into the air, not making any sense. No, verse 10, though, he's speaking the fact that really there is no communication process happening. Verse 10, there are, it may be, so many kinds of languages in the world, and none of them is about significance. Therefore, if I do not know the meaning of the language, I shall be a foreigner to him who speaks, and he who speaks will be a foreigner to me. Now, we've all encountered somebody that doesn't speak English, right? And that process of trying to communicate is like what? You go into sign language, or you try to do like you mock, not mock, but you do your, you know, Spanglish or Japanese-ish, whatever. And me and Cheryl, we were down at Grauman's Chinese Theater, about a month ago. Never been there before, just went to check out the stars and the handprints and all that. And there was a Japanese lady there. And she was trying to talk to me. She wanted to find out where a star was for a person that was in this movie. That was the interpretation. But she's speaking a little bit of her language, broken English, whatever, and just basically was just pointing. There's no communication. I finally got the gist of what she said, and I just went. I mean, that was my way of saying, I don't know in your language. Universal. And then, though, the same lady walked up to me, I don't mean the mocking. She said in her language accent, do you know where Michael Jackson's star is? Oh, yeah, it's right over here. I took over. I was a tour guide there. So. Anyhow, tongues fall short because they're not easy to understand and there's really no communication. We're like foreigners going back and forth when we hear that. But now, though, moving on, verse 12 through 17, we see that edification is greater. What does he say here? Even so you, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, let it be for the edification of the church that you seek to excel. Not for yourself, not to, well, you know what, so-and-so has this gift I'm going for because they get all kinds of praise. They get all kinds of attention. I want some of that attention. So I'm going to excel in that gift. No, 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 no. Don't do that. Tongues won't edify unless they are interpreted, he says here. Therefore, let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret, because it's useless otherwise. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. Tongues won't edify unless they're interpreted. And you got to understand that in this process, that's the problem with it. Edification is greater. Verse 15, though, what is the conclusion then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I also pray with understanding. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with understanding. Basically saying, hey, you got the gift, use it, but at the same time, go ahead, but speak with understanding as well. In other words, Paul was saying, I'll speak in a tongue, but I can also speak that and make it communicatable to you so you understand what I'm speaking. He's talking about using both there. But the greater, of course, is the edification. In verse 16, though, he goes on to say, otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, how will he who occupies the place of the uninformed say amen at your giving of thanks, since he doesn't understand what you say? For you indeed give thanks well, but the other is not edified. He wants everyone to seek that all are edified in this. And again, the two things he's talking about, he's setting the church in order. He's obviously elevating the gift of prophecy, which is, of course, what he encourages them to do. But now we see in verse 18 through 19, we see Paul's preference. I thank God I speak with tongues more than you all. Yet in the church, I would rather speak 5 words with understanding that I may teach others also than 10,000 words of tongues. Of course, Paul encouraging them in public, emphasizing the greatness of prophecy, and of course, going back to that 5 versus 10,000, it's a huge difference. I don't think he could have made it any greater significance in what he was saying. And of course, the Corinthians, they weren't digging it because they liked that gift of tongues. They liked that attention that it got. Now, I don't know about any of you, but if you've ever been in a place where there's a speaking of tongues, it is a bit different. It is a bit bizarre. I'll get to that in a bit, but we see Paul's preference. But now, though, verse 20 through 25, we see Paul's correction. This is an interesting passage of Scripture. There's differences of interpretation and what it was speaking, and not controversy, but of course, all through the years, ages, there's a different interpretation. And also, in reading this passage, you have those who are the persuasion that the gifts of tongues, prophecy, all ended back in the first century church. It accomplished what it was needed for, and they believe that it has ended. So they'll interpret this passage completely different than someone. We of Calvary, we believe the gifts are still for today. The gifts are still in operation, and it's there still until the perfect comes, until Christ returns. But the others are saying, nope. The Holy Spirit's gifts were ended back then, the apostolic age, whatever, and they're not in operation today. So you can take that for whatever it is, but we believe they're still in operation. But verse 20 says, brethren, do not be children in understanding. However, in malice be babes, but in understanding be mature. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips I will speak to this people, and yet for all that, they will not listen, says the Lord. Interesting. So what Paul's saying, first he's saying in verse 20, he says, Corinthians, grow up. Be mature in understanding, not in evil. Be mature in working with each other and not in malice and not in evil being divided. Even in the area of these gifts, using them for themselves. Using them as a way of even causing division. Okay? But then in verse 21, he says, now Corinthians, listen up though. Take heed. Now, Paul uses the scripture from Isaiah as a warning. Back then, strange tongues were not a blessing but a curse. Strange tongues of a nation coming in to bring judgment upon the children of Israel is what he's referring to. So what he's saying is, take heed, you guys, to not be dwelling and so focused on the gift of tongues, but that you forget the giver of the gift and the reason why he would give this. And it, what it was designed for was to be a blessing, but the way they were using it and the way they were abusing it, it was going to become a curse to them because it wasn't what God wanted. And God was going to bring, of course, the correction. He was bringing the correction through the Apostle Paul. Now, verse 22, though, we see that tongues is a sign. Sign for unbelievers, not for believers. Interesting. And some think that even in this passage that the scribe, those who copied this, some think they kind of copied it wrong because it kind of sounds like it contradicts, but it doesn't. I'll explain here. Verse 22, therefore tongues are for a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. But prophesying is not for unbelievers, but for those who believe. What are you saying here? Well, tongues a sign for unbelievers. It's a sign of God's power and presence, a supernatural work, no doubt. Now, back when I first got saved, friends of ours, they attended Hal Lindsey's church to Telestai up in the hill where Ben went. The old man here. Gonna get a witness, yeah. Well, I was new in the Lord, and we go in, and there was a special service that night at the church. It was over there where King's Harbor is now. And the speaker up there, doing this thing, whatever, and all of a sudden, it was some, I think it was like part of it, like a little bit of a worship afterglow. He all of a sudden goes off speaking in tongues up on stage there. And I got to tell you, immediately it was like, I ain't liking this. I'm feeling uncomfortable. This is a little strange. Then he went ahead and interpreted it himself. So it was bizarre. So in this idea here, tongues for the unbelievers, there was something happening. And me, I was a believer, but I was a new believer. And so it kind of just, whoa, what in the world was that? What's that all about? But it's not for believers. Why? Because believers already believe. You're understanding. You believe. You already know. Now, verse 23, we have the problem with tongues, though. Okay? Verse 23, therefore, if the whole church comes together in one place and all speak with tongues, and there comes in those who are uninformed and or unbelievers, will they not say that you are out of your mind? Isn't that a crazy description? Now, there are those that are here that have attended Pentecostal churches. And I've been told, I never walked into a Pentecostal church, but I've told you can walk into a Pentecostal church and you think, this place is bananas. It is crazy. And of course, we all heard about, the Toronto blessing and all that stuff that was going on. And you've seen videos of just, this is church, people flipping and flopping on the floor and barking and acting like dogs and holy laughter and people going, the whole place, pandemonium, out of control, crazy. Guys on stage having tongue contests and people praising God thinking, this is great. This is awesome. The problem with tongues, though, the unbelievers, they'd be scared off. Not understanding, no edification, made to feel uncomfortable, walking out the door saying, this Christianity is for nuts. So that's what Paul is saying. So we have for unbelievers, we have not for believers, and we have this problem with the tongues. But now, verse 20 through for 25, we have the benefits, though, of prophecy, going back to this. But if all prophesy and an unbeliever or uninformed person comes in, he is convinced by all, he is convicted by all, and thus the secrets of his hearts are revealed, and so, falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is truly among you. See, so if they're speaking in tongues, but if they come in hearing prophecy, even though they're not believers, the prophecy going forth more than likely is going to include the gospel, some type of work of the Holy Spirit operating people, bringing conviction, bringing salvation. So you see prophecy so far greater, Paul is saying, than the gift of tongues. edification greater. We have Paul's preference, his correction, and of course the benefits of this. So now section two of this chapter, doing okay here, verse 26 through 40, we have the gifts and the use in the church. So verse 26, basically he's saying, let all be done again for edification. How is it then, brethren, whether you come together, each of you has psalm, a teaching, a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation. Hey, let it be done for edification. They were competing with one another. They wanted to be seen. They wanted to outdo the person next to them. The problem, of course, the church would come together. They all wanted to participate at the same time. They all wanted to bring glory to themselves. They all wanted attention and preeminence. So Paul is correcting that. He corrects them. Verse 27, now he's outlining, okay, here's the proper use of tongues. Also, here's the proper use of prophecy. He lays it out. This is how it is to be done. This is what I want you to do. Verse 27, if anyone speaks in a tongue, let there be two or three, at three each in turn, and let one interpret. So not all at the same time, all going off at the same time. One at a time, let there be an interpretation. But if there is no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. Okay, we call that a prayer language. Two or three at most. And if there's no interpreter, it's not valid for the public. Now, though, we have the proper use of prophecy, verse 29 through 33. Now let two or three prophets speak, and let the others judge. But if anything is revealed to another who sits by, let the first keep silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be encouraged. So two or three to speak, others would validate. Someone stands up, thus says the Lord, whatever. Yeah, we bear witness to that. Now, if there was a new revelation in this prophecy exchange, it took precedence over someone who might be repeating what someone else already said. Thus says the Lord, God is good. Yes, thus says the Lord, God is good. They were repeating. The next revelation that would come that would be different would be greater. Receive more. But the whole idea of prophecy was to encourage and to teach the hearers. For you can all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be encouraged. But now he says here, verse 32, and the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. What he's saying is that God's spirit is not going to make you act crazy. And what he was trying to do was bring a distinction between what happens when a person is demon-possessed and what happens when a person is, in a sense, possessed by the Spirit of God. Demon possession, I don't know if you've encountered that. I think I've talked about that before. The person has no control over what is going on. The demons just, they go where the demon goes, in a sense. They act the way the demon wants to act. When the Holy Spirit comes upon a person, you still have all your faculties. You're not going to be made to do something that is crazy, stupid, out of control, that will embarrass yourself, like barking like a dog, or uncontrollable laughter, or uncontrollable crying, or flopping on the ground back and forth like a trout. That's not, the Holy Spirit doesn't do that. The Holy Spirit is a gentleman. So acting out or shouting or making interruptions in the case of what was going on, that isn't the Spirit of God. And then verse 33 says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. What he's saying here is that the Holy Spirit isn't going to interrupt himself. Now here's the deal. Pastor Jeff is teaching. He is being used by God, the Holy Spirit. He is prophesying, speaking forth the word of God. The Holy Spirit is in operation. The Spirit of God is moving. Well, the Spirit of God isn't going to inspire someone in the audience to stand up while Jeff is saying, hey, turn with me, and all of a sudden this person stands up and just starts going off on a tongue. We're not going to honor that as a valid tongue or as someone who's actually being filled with the Spirit. They're filled with themselves. or they got a demon. We've had that before. So they will be politely, kindly, gently asked to either be quiet or leave. Now, if Pastor Jeff is up there teaching and the Spirit of God leads him to say, does someone out there have a tongue right now? And the Spirit inspires, you know, Randy to stand up and give a tongue. And then, you know, Bob stands up and gives the interpretation. That is the Spirit of God operating properly. He didn't interrupt himself. He directed it. He had it over here. He had it over there. People go, whoa, that was cool. Praise the Lord. And Jeff goes back to teaching. That's the right way of doing it, not the improper way. Holy Spirit's not going to interrupt himself. And so when the pulpit is in operation, the public expression of something that is completely contrary to what is being going on in the pulpit, it's not valid. It's not the Spirit of God. All things, as we see, are to be done decently and in order. So now moving on, though, verse 34 through 35, we have proper behavior for women. Now remember, context is needed here. Amen. Needed. Remember, Paul is setting things in order in the church. And I don't know about you, when I first came to church, I really didn't know how to act in church. I kind of acted like everybody else. Oh, you're supposed to, okay, you sit down now. Okay, oh, you're supposed to stand up now. Oh, you raise your hands now. Oh, we're supposed to sing now, you know. You follow me? You know how to act. Now, if you came in and you kind of just wanted to kind of do your own thing, you could see where you could probably cause a problem within the church. And, of course, Corinthians being a little bit prideful, being a little bit arrogant, being a little haughty, as we know, I can walk in this church and kind of do what I want to do. So what was taking place here, of course, and then back then, of course, how it was set up is that oftentimes the women would sit on one side and the men would sit on the other side. And someone would be teaching. Someone would give a prophecy. And the wife is over here. Hey, Joe! Yeah. Joe, what did you say, man? I'm mocking the lady. She should be more like, hey, Joe. Yes, dear. What is he saying? You know, that kind of a thing. So Paul is setting things in order. He's not saying women could not prophesy or pray. Remember chapter 11, verse 5. What does it say? If a woman prays or prophesies, let her head be covered. So he wasn't saying they can't do that. But what he is saying is that women could not judge the prophecy. That was reserved for the male leadership of the church. It was restricted to that. That was all part of the law, the way things were set up. So basically, number one, he's saying no talking out. Don't be asking husbands what he said. He says here, let your women keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but they are to be submissive, as the law also says. And if they want to learn something, let them ask their own husbands at home, for it is shame for women to speak in church. It was shameful for them to interrupt the service, speak out, say something across the room while the guy on the stage or someone's given a tongue or someone's given a prophecy, whatever, and you follow what I'm saying. And there's nothing more distracting than not only to be in church and hear people talking, but like when you go to the movies, don't you hate that? Somebody behind you, all they do is talk to the whole movie. I got to get up and move, honey. It's driving me crazy. So that's what he's saying here. Paul is asking the women to don't be talking, be submissive, wait and be patient, learn from your husbands. Don't ask questions across the aisle, it interrupts the order of the service, just as would, in verse 26, everything being done at the same time. Follow now? So now you can see Paul's not like slamming the women, they can't speak, they can't say nothing. He's just setting things in order so there was proper order in the service, so there wasn't out of control, wasn't crazy. Now we see, lastly here, Paul's concluding comments, verse 36 through 40. Basically, this is interesting. Now, he kind of like punches them here. Verse 36, or did the word of God come originally from you? Or was it you only that it reached? Now, the Corinthians were pretty arrogant. They thought that they had it all together. They thought they knew more than the Apostle Paul, remember? So Paul's really just saying, hey, you know what? Don't challenge me in this, Corinthians. Don't challenge what I'm teaching you here. This is being taught in all the churches. This is correct. This is what I have received from the Lord. You guys haven't received that. You think you have. And he's basically, kind of giving a little spanking there. Then he says, though, you who are spiritual should discern that I am speaking the truth. Verse 37, if anyone thinks himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things which I write to you are the commandments of the Lord. Hey, if you're spiritual, if you got these, you know that I'm telling the truth. You discern this is right, is what he's saying. But then he goes, but if anyone is ignorant, let him be ignorant. If anyone does not recognize this, then he's not recognizing. Basically, Paul's saying they're ignorant and it is what it is. I'm not going to be able to change the way that they think. And then verse 39 through 40 again, desire prophecy. Therefore, brethren, desire earnestly to prophesy and do not forbid to speak with tongues. Let all things be done decently and in order. Don't go to the extreme of banning tongues. Paul said no tongues. Nope, I didn't say that. Do it right in the church, decently, in order, not chaos, not pandemonium, not as if somebody switched off the gravity button in the church. All right, makes sense? Now, let's go back to verses 1 through 4. The greater gift. Paul said, desire earnestly to prophesy. And in this here, again, we're pursuing love, we're desiring these gifts. For he who speaks a tongue doesn't speak to men but to God. But verse 3, but he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. Here's what it's all about. Here's what he's trying to get at. Because he who prophesies speaks edification, exhortation, comfort. So, what is edification? The edification, of course, is the act of building someone up. One who promotes another's Christian growth or wisdom or piety or happiness or holiness. Basically, it's me coming alongside you, you come alongside me, you teaching me, me teaching you what you need to do in order to be better at what you're doing, to be a stronger Christian, a better Christian, or even to become a Christian, how to improve. And an example would be, sin is wrong. That's edification, letting you know the truth. Hey, this is the truth here. Sin is wrong. Simple as that. Edification. But now exhortation means to urge, advise, or warn earnestly. And this is a little bit more challenging. This is where that gift of discernment comes in, where love really takes hold, because if you see something going on in somebody's life and it's detrimental to their Christian walk, it's detrimental to their lives in a sense, you need to speak up. You know, somebody's going to run a red light. Well, there he goes. Okay, I'll just let him walk across the street or whatever, walking through. No, you're going to say something. And you're going to give urgent advice. You're going to give recommendations or warnings with the emphasis, though, on comforting the heart, on encouraging the heart. We need to look and discern, but it's also, the issue is confronting somebody. Hey, brother, I noticed this going on. Let's use language. Christian brother, you work alongside of him. He comes to church with you, but you hear him. We'll use the docks. You hear him down the docks, just, whoa. Hey, brother, come here a second, man. Hey, do you realize what you said? Well, what'd I say? Well, you beep, bleep, beep, 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 bleep, beep. That's what you said. Now, you would say beep, bleep, you wouldn't say what he said, but you would tell him that what he said. And so you're encouraging and challenging where they might be wrong in a situation. It's not the best. So edification, sin is wrong. Exhortation, you are a sinner. You see the difference there? Sin is wrong, hey, just letting you know the deal. But the exhortation is, but you know what, you're the sinner. You've got a problem. You've got an issue. You've got something you need to take a look at. And it's done, of course, in absolute love. pursuing love. And then he who prophesies speaks comfort to men. To give strength, to give hope, to give encouragement means, of course, presenting the promises of the gospel, the hopes that are there, administering comfort in time of trial. So if this same person you've edified, you've exhorted, but now at the same time, now you comfort that person. Because in a sense, you told them the truth, you told them that truth applied to them, but now you want to lift them up, you want to encourage them. You don't want to beat somebody down. You want to tell somebody that they're a sinner and shame them and make them feel bad. No, no, no. Dude, hey, here's it is. Need to always leave them with hope, in on positive. Man, God loves you, though. God has a plan in this. God forgives you. You point them to the one that helps. So the example, of course, sin is wrong. You're a sinner, but here in comfort, Jesus saves us from our sins. We have hope. We have life. We got liberty. All in Jesus. And this is what, of course, edifies the church. And we think about it, even the Old Testament prophets, this is what they did in their prophecy. Man, they laid it out, the truth. You guys are messing up. And they laid out the warning. You know, you don't fix this up. God's coming. But they would always point them to God, to the repentance, to the plan that God would have if they would just turn. All through the prophets, it's bam, bam, bam. Forgot who it is. There's one prophet that just basically says, it's over with, guys. You're toast. You're dead. You better run for the hills anyhow. But most of them always had return to me. So you see this, as Christians, prophecy, that's why it's the most important. That's why we need to earnestly desire this gift, that we can edify and exhort and comfort others. And this really is kind of what the Christianity is all about. It's the EECs, the Christianity, that we need to, as men of God, ask for, pray for, and then, of course, practice in everywhere we go, in all that we're doing, in your Bible teaching, in your coming alongside, your group with your men. Just, man, that's what it's all about. Because really, that's exactly what Jesus does and what Jesus did for us, right? The Holy Spirit comes. What did he do? He revealed to you. Guess what? Sin is wrong. What you're doing is not good. But also he revealed to what? Guess what, though? You aren't the man kind of a deal. You're the sinner. Oh, me, yeah. Well, guess what? I got a plan. I'm going to come. I'm going to forgive that sin. I'm going to lift you up. I'm going to change your life. I'm going to set you free from the bondage of the devil. I'm going to give you a plan for your life. I'm going to give you a purpose. I'm going to give you the hope of heaven. I'm going to give you joy unspeakable. All these sayings that we got in Jesus. Isn't it awesome? So I love this chapter. It is very interesting. But Paul, man, pursue love, you guys. Desire, though, gifts that you may prophesy. Tongues, enjoy them yourself, but don't elevate them where they're not supposed to be, because they don't do in the church what prophesying can do. All righty, guys, let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the instruction, the Apostle Paul. Thank you for the correction that was there. And Lord, even for ourselves, being edified, instructed, and taught in these areas. But Lord, I do pray that for all of us, Lord, that there would be that pursuit, that desire for the gifts that bless others, Lord, that lift them up, that build them up. Lord, again, being reminded that any gift that we receive is from you and not anything to do with us and not for our purpose, not for us to boast in or glory in, but Lord, to let you use us for you, for your kingdom's sake. So bless these guys in their groups. Continue strengthening them, lifting them up, Lord. And again, Lord, lifting up all things to you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.